Protesters gathered outside the U.S. Supreme Court against reinstating the death penalty for the Boston Marathon bomber. I'm going away, and I'll tell you more coming up.
Howard University are going into their second day of a sit-in protest. I'm Michael Hernandez, and I'll have more coming up.
A virus that's common in children is spiking months ahead of schedule, and parents are being caught off guard. I'm Stephen Milling, and I'll have the details on how to keep your children safe coming up. CNS TV News starts now.
Be moved just like a tree that's standing by the waters. We shall not be moved. No more executions. We shall not be moved.
Passionate pleas tonight
no
at the
more
Supreme
executions.
Court.
We shall not be moved.
We'll take you live to the nation's highest court in just a minute. I'm Stephen Mailing.
But late this afternoon, stunning news from the state's highest court on a brutal murder that rocked the College Park community. I'm Michael Hernandez.
In breaking news tonight, the new trial request from the lawyers of convicted murderer Sean Urbanski. Urbanski was convicted and sentenced to life in prison after murdering Lieutenant Richard Collins III at a bus stop outside Montgomery Hall on the University of Maryland College Park campus. He was tried and convicted of first-degree murder. He was also originally charged with the hate crime statute, but the prosecution did not present enough evidence, according to the courts. Urbanski's lawyers claim his trial violated his First and 14th Amendment rights to free speech and due process. Capital News Service reached out to Urbanski's lawyers for comment. Our calls have not been returned. But the calls to put an end to the death penalty are loud and clear outside the U.S. Supreme Court. The court is hearing the case against Boston Marathon bomber Dzhokhar Tsarnaev. He was convicted of carrying out the bombings in 2013. An appeals court upheld the conviction but ruled his death sentence should be overturned on technicalities. CNS's Glory Guay joins us live outside the Supreme Court where protesters say, let him live. Glory?
Over a dozen protesters gathered outside right here of the U.S. Supreme Court. This comes after... Over a dozen protesters gathered outside here of the Supreme Court to voice their disapproval of the death penalty. This comes as the U.S. Supreme Court decides whether or not to reinstate Dzhokhar Tsarnaev's death penalty.
We shall not be moved. No more executions. We shall not be moved just like a...
Which is why they were moved to travel great distances to the steps of the U.S. Supreme Court to protest the death penalty.
My main concern was to come out and defend life.
63-year-old Charles Keith traveled from Ohio. He has been an activist against the death penalty for more than 10 years. Keith says he knows the pain of the death penalty firsthand. His older brother was taken off death row just 13 days before his execution date and is now serving a life sentence.
If you have someone that you want to die, you want someone to kill them for you, but in your heart you're for that, there's not much difference between you and that killer.
And Keith's other brother was murdered. Keith says if his brother's killer is ever found, he would not wish them death.
This is the time for forgiveness and mercy because you can't bring loved ones back. I have a brother. But what I had to do in my heart was forgive because it was literally eating me up on the inside.
The federal appeals court threw out the Boston Marathon bomber's death sentence last year, stating mistakes in the trial. Now, the Supreme Court considers reinstating it. These protesters say it is inhumane to take away the life of another, no matter the crime, especially at its highest level.
Even though Tsarnaev is undeniably guilty, we still want the court to respect his right to life as a human being.
Maria Oswald says they are not demonstrating to take away from the victims and their families, but to protect every human's life.
We're calling to rehumanize Tsarnaev, of course, but we want to rehumanize the victims as well.
Herb Garrity agrees. He says criminals of all kind are often dehumanized in the judicial process.
And right now that is what we're doing with this idea, this intrinsic idea of innocence or guilt being the determining factor for whether or not you deserve the inherent right to life.
Whether or not the Boston Marathon bombers death sentence is reinstated, it is unclear whether he would actually be put to death. The Biden administration has made it clear that they are against capital punishment. The Supreme Court is expected to reach a decision at the end of their session, which is June 2022. We will keep you updated. Reporting live from the Supreme Court, I'm Glory Nguyen. Back to you, Michael.
Thank you, Glory. Another protest tonight not far from the Supreme Court. Students at Howard University are fighting what they say are poor housing conditions. Today is their second day of a sit-in protest where they have taken a Blackburn University Center. I spoke with one of the lead organizers. She says the university's administration is ignoring them and they are tired of it.
Keep the light down, y'all. We're talking to you.
The LIV movement is staging a sit-in at Howard University. This after they say administration officials failed to attend a town hall students organized. They are complaining of poor housing conditions and lack of student representation on the Board of Trustees.
Students decided that we have to stop, doing it the way in which we have been doing it, which is calling, emailing, continuously trying to meet, continuously trying to speak.
The Vice President of Student Affairs, Dr. Cynthia Evers, says students were at a town hall meeting where a discussion was going on, but that a small group interrupted what she says was constructive dialogue and instigated a sit-in instead.
When we were already inside of Blackburn when we decided to stay, and nothing was forced. We did not force our way in. We walked in.
Some fellow Howard University students who are not directly participating in the protests say they support the sit-in.
It needs to be supported by a whole group. One person can't do it alone.
But it's also an opportunity for people that are watching Howard and looking at us as the future leaders of the minority community, not just in business, but in the world as a whole, to see that we have a voice and we need to be heard as well as have our needs met for the tuition that we pay.
And inside the Blackburn University Center, there's approximately 50 students inside, and they're saying they're not leaving until their demands are met.
We're not in here because it's a big slumber party. We're in here because we can relate to the problems and the demands that we have.
Yesterday, the university sent a campus-wide email asking students to peacefully vacate the Blackburn Multipurpose Center by noon. Students still remain in the building at this time. The university says those who do not vacate will face consequences that can include expulsion from the university.
Now, Tuesday's Metro derailment is still affecting DMV transportation today. The Blue Line is closed between the Rosslyn and Pentagon Station, and it will only operate between Franconia Springfield and Mount Vernon Square Station. To help anyone who is affected by these rail closures, shuttle buses are free of charge between Rosslyn, Arlington Cemetery, and Pentagon Station. Delays are expected on the Blue, Orange, and Silver lines because of single tracking.
If you got the Moderna vaccine, listen up. Today, the FDA's Vaccine Advisory Committee recommended giving Moderna booster shots to anyone 65 and older and other vulnerable people. The FDA has not made an official statement on a Moderna booster, but this recommendation is a step in the right direction, and a final decision can be made in the next couple of days. If the booster is confirmed by the FDA, the CDC would then have to vote on it next week. And while the Moderna vaccine was just approved for booster purposes, COVID cases in the state continue to rise among kids. In the past 2 weeks, kids under the age of 10 have seen more than 15% increase in positive cases. There has also been almost a 10% increase in COVID deaths among 20 to 39-year-olds, while there's only been a 3% increase in deaths among people over the age of 80.
Now, after 3 weeks in the clear, RSV has returned to the DMV area. Since September 11th, positive antigen tests in the state of Maryland had been at 0%. But the CDC reported on October 2nd that positive tests have gone up to 10%. I spoke with a doctor at the National Children's Center in D.C. to find out how to keep your children safe from this virus.
It's something we normally see each year and see peaks around January, February. So to see large numbers of RSV in the late summer, early fall is certainly unusual.
Respiratory syncytial virus, or RSV, is common among children, but not in the fall. Hospitals have to get creative, especially during this COVID pandemic.
We would expect over the next few weeks that our hospital is operating at or very close to capacity. So we've had to innovate and think creatively about how to continue making sure that we can provide top care for all kids.
Now, because hospitals like the Children's Center here in D.C. are nearing capacity, it's going to take a little longer than expected to be seen. Now, if parents think their child should be seen by a doctor, they should be on the lookout for the following symptoms: rapid breathing, wheezing, and chest contractions. And Dr. Ward says that parents' first point of contact when they are concerned should always be their family doctor.
They will often have the ability to get kids in for sick visits. Telehealth infrastructure is much more robust than it was pre the pandemic.
And for those kids whose symptoms are severe, Dr. Ward says parents should not hesitate to go to a hospital or emergency room.
We remain open 24/7, ready to see them. And we have staff who are triaging those patients and reassessing them if their condition is worsening before they're able to be seen by a physician.
Dr. Ward also added that the best way to stay safe is to do the following: wash your hands, eat right, and continue to wear your mask.
There's a new steed in town at the farm, the University of Maryland College Park, that is. 10-year-old Odin just left quarantine, a normal procedure for horses that was happening well before the pandemic began. The origin of Odin is unknown, but farm manager Crystal Caldwell believes Odin might have been raised by the Amish. He is the sixth horse to join the farm and is also the first one to be brought, as the farm was desperate for horses.
The country has its eyes on a DMV governor's race, and it's heating up. We'll give you an update on that next.
Plus, part of College Park goes pink. We'll tell you where and why next. Stay with us.
When I was in foster care, I never knew when I would have to move. So I always had my suitcase ready to go. Then one day, I was adopted. My new parents opened their hearts and home to me. My parents cook my favorite breakfast for me every morning. My parents take me on trips I never thought I would go on. They gave me a home and an even better reason to use that suitcase. My parents aren't perfect, but they're perfect for me.
Oh, sweetie. Okay, you know what? Let's take off his sweatshirt. Get rid of pictures of him. You don't have to look at him. Goodbye, Dave.
Mom, you don't understand. He's tagged in like 400 of my posts.
I can cut out tags.
No, that's not how it works.
What is a tag?
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. Thousands of teens in foster care would love to share their first with you.
Había un niño que era muy sensible a luces y sonidos. Construía escondites donde no podían entrar. No le gustaba mirar a la gente a los ojos. Lo hacía sentir incómodo. Un día se descubrió que tenía autismo. Con ayuda, poco a poco, aprendió a vivir mejor con ello.
Mientras más pronto se diagnostique, mejor. Conoce las señales en autismspeaks.org.
Back to CNS TV. If you're looking forward to voting in 22's midterm elections, keep an eye on the Virginia governor's race. Democrat Terry McAuliffe is leading Republican Glenn Youngkin. By 3 points in the latest CBS News poll. McAuliffe will rely on early votes ahead of the November 2nd election. But Youngkin is currently polling well with the independent voters, which is a good sign for the Republican candidate.
Political analysts think the race will be an indicator of how the 2022 midterm elections may go. But Maryland's population grew unevenly over the past 10 years, and that presents a challenge for redistricting groups because it changes how districts are represented in Congress. CNS's Allison Mollenkamp has been looking at redistricting and joins us in the studio with details. Allison?
Population grew the fastest in central parts of the state, including Frederick, Howard, and Charles counties. Meanwhile, Baltimore City, parts of the Eastern Shore, and Western Maryland all lost population. Congressional and legislative districts need to be equal in population, which means this uneven growth will force those lines to change. Congressional districts need to be as close to equal as possible under federal law, but legislative districts get a little more leeway, as much as 5% above or below the ideal population of around 131,000 people. I spoke with State Senator Brian Simonaire, a Republican serving on the legislator's redistricting commission. He says that 5% number has been used for political advantage in the past. A possible example can be seen in Prince George's County and the Eastern Shore. At the time of the last redistricting, after the 2010 census, districts 24, 25, and 26 in PG County each had populations under 118,000, while districts 36 and 37 on the Eastern Shore were closer to 128,000 each. The idea would be that Democratic voters in PG County are then more represented than Republican voters packed into those larger districts. But not everyone is opposed to the 5% variance. Out in Western Maryland, State Senator George Edwards actually requested that redistricting allow a Western Maryland district to be underpopulated to deal with its population loss.
Now, Allison, when will we know when these new legislative districts will, when will we know when they'll look?
The Legislative Redistricting Advisory Commission has said it plans to release draft maps, at least on the congressional side, by mid-November.
And how will new maps become law?
We're expecting a special session on congressional redistricting this December, but legislative maps probably won't come up until the regular session in January.
Thank you, Allison. As many of you know, October is Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Tonight, the Maryland's women's soccer team will bring awareness by hosting its Pink Out game. The team will wear pink warm-up shirts before the game against Rutgers. There will also be this pink ribbon on the sideline along with the team wearing pink accessories during the game. Kickoff is set for 7 p.m. and you can catch the game on BTN Plus.
Well, hockey is back in D.C., and the Washington Capitals played in front of a packed crowd at Capital One Arena for the first time in a long time.
Kevin McNulty is next with sports. Kevin.
That's right. Caps fans went home really happy last night, and they got to witness a couple of milestones along the way. And we'll take a look at Maryland football, where they stand during their bye week after that tough loss at Ohio State. That's next in sports.
The black truck? Hey, Christina from accounting.
Yeah, hi.
Hey, I used to date a girl named Christina.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and then she dumped me for my best friend. You want to see some photos of them that I took?
I don't.
I thought we talked about this, buddy.
Buzz and overshared again?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm going to call a car.
That's a smart idea.
So, yeah, I know. That's why I did it.
Hey, you're going to get back to the top of the mountain.
Does that mean I'm going to get back with Christina?
No.
Oh.
No.
Here you go.
Thank you.
Thank you.
In his 17th season in the NHL, 36-year-old Alexander Ovechkin is still breaking records in the league.
CNS's Kevin McNulty is here to show us what Ovi did last night. Kevin.
Who knew opening night was going to be
such a historic night for the Caps? First of all, the Caps defeated the New York Rangers handily 5-1, moving them to 1-0 on the year. But somehow, that wasn't the most impressive part of the night, because two goals off the stick of Alexander Ovechkin put him into elite company. Now, the Capitals were already leading 3-0 when he nailed this wrister for goal number 731 of his career, tying him for fifth in NHL history. But you know Ovechkin, he wanted that fifth spot all to himself. So 8 minutes left in the third, he zooms past the Rangers net and notches number 732, passing Marcel Dion. Congrats to Ovi, who could realistically move into third all-time by the end of the season. Here's Ovechkin on the atmosphere at Capital One last night.
The atmosphere is crazy in a way. I think we're all missing it the last couple of years, but it's a total different feeling when everybody cheering for you. It doesn't matter what happened, you can still hear the crowd, and it's going to give you energy.
And like I said, Ovechkin wasn't the only one making history at Capital One Wednesday night. 19-year-old rookie Hendrix Lapierre scored his first career goal in his league debut. And Peter Laviolette won his 674th game as a head coach, which passes John Tortorella for the most wins by an American-born head coach in NHL history. It was quite the opening night for a very exciting Caps team. And now flipping over to football, and the Washington football team is preparing maybe its toughest opponent of the season, the Kansas City Chiefs, but the organization has had more off-the-field distractions this week. Several of the statements made via email by disgraced Raiders head coach John Gruden surfaced over the weekend. It was revealed that Gruden's emails were uncovered as a part of the probe into the Washington football team's toxic culture, according to the LA Times. The probe reviewed more than 650,000 emails, and only Gruden's and ESPN reporter Adam Schefter's correspondence with the team has been made public, leaving many to believe that the worst is to come for Washington. Meanwhile, reaction to Gruden's racist, misogynistic, and homophobic comments has been pouring in from across the league. And here's what LA Chargers head coach Brandon Staley had to say about Gruden and his leadership.
I think that respect and trust in this world are really, really difficult to achieve. And I think about all the people that were affected by those emails, whether you're a person of color, whether you're a person, gender, your sexual orientation, the people that were affected by those emails, that's who I'm thinking about.
And Staley has received widespread praise for those comments. He and his Chargers will travel to Baltimore to take on the Ravens this Sunday. And from the NFL to college football, the Maryland Terrapins have a much needed bye week, and they'll have an extra week to get ready and get healthy for Minnesota on October 23rd. But the sting of the Terps' 66-17 loss at Ohio State on Saturday still persists. A deflated defense didn't help Maryland's cause against the Buckeyes, but without Dante Demas and Jayshon Jones, the offense couldn't even get things moving on the ground. I was in Columbus for the beatdown. Talia Tungavailoa's options were limited from the get-go after the injury to NFL hopeful Demas in Week 5 and another injury to Jayshon Jones on the first drive of the game Saturday. The second-year quarterback hoped to rely on a running back room that was solid through four games, but that wasn't the case.
When it's our time to throw the ball, you know, I got to be able to deliver. And, you know, whether it's our running game is not working, you know, we still believe in our running game no matter what. You know, we're always going to try to pound the ball, establish the run, whether it's me or our running backs.
The Terps' offense did a better job fighting through injuries against the Buckeyes than the defense did. But they certainly didn't expect former walk-on Shalon Faumautau to be their leading rusher on Saturday. Mike Locksley just hopes they can find a good mix of run, pass, and RPO going forward.
It's all about balance. I mean, for us to be the type of offense, when we're clicking, we're able to run the ball, we're able to add our RPOs to it, we're able to throw the ball. What we've got to do is, as I said here at the halfway point, is we need to take a look at everything we've done the first six games, self-scout it. See what we need to adjust, see what the direction we need to go in all three phases, offensively, defensively, and special teams. You know, how you start the season doesn't always mean that's how you end based on the personnel you have available, and that's what we need to take a deep dive into.
And after this bye week, the Terps have their best opportunities to get back in the win column against Minnesota and at home against Indiana. So they'll definitely want to shore up that run game before then. But guys, a bowl game still isn't out of the question for this Terps team. They only need two more wins to be at 500 for the regular season, and they'd be bowl eligible then.
Yeah, that sounds great. I mean, you know, always rooting for the Terps here at the University of Maryland.
Something very exciting for the Terps.
Well, yeah, it's October, but it feels more like July. We'll tell you
when fall will be ready to arrive. Up next.
If I could go back and change it all, I would. I think I'm gonna miss you the most. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. maybe it's just the little moments. If I could go back and change it all, if I could go back, I would. But I can't.
When I first saw Turtle, my heart was full. Not anything but lonely.
We had this like deep connection, this heart connection.
He just wants to be close to you and part of your life.
Every day with Turtle is a perfect day.
When I'm holding her, it makes me feel calmer.
I think everything he does shows how much he loves us.
When we adopt a shelter pet, we discover they're a little bit of a lot of things.
But they're all pure love.
Well, the calendar says one thing tonight, and the weather says something else entirely. What's going on, Steven?
Yeah, you know, it's definitely a nice day as we look outside at McKeldin Mall here at the University of Maryland in College Park. But, you know, it's been a really nice past couple of weeks, honestly. We've had a decent amount of sun out there, and, you know, we've been able to be outside. Barbecue grills are out. It's great for football. But right now, you know, we're looking in the current weather, and we're looking at a high of 79 with a low of 57. But tonight, we're dropping it to the mid to low 60s. But tomorrow, we're talking a high of 82 and a low of 57. It's going to be sunny, but Saturday's when we see the rain. Saturday's going to have a high of 75 and a low of 52. We're at a 60% chance of rain. You know, forwarding that over, looking at the U.S. Doppler radar right now, we're going to see, you're going to see this cold front pushing in from the Midwest. And that's actually the top of this up here is going to curve in and hit the DMV area. So expect a little less than an inch of rain when it hits. It's going to hit in the afternoon is what they're predicting right now. You know, we're going to lead this to our five-day look ahead, though, because it's nothing but sunny skies most of the way as we're looking. Friday, sunny and hot. Saturday, rain, though. That Saturday rain really is going to put a damper, but it's going to bring the temps down. Sunday's prime football weather with the highs and lows in the low 60s. Monday is sunny and low 60s as a high, but when you're also talking about Tuesday, it's a little warmer, it's 70, with a low of 43, and we're finally, hopefully, cracking into that fall weather that we all have been waiting for since, you know, it is October after all.
And I'm just ready for this fall weather already.
Oh yeah, man, I'm ready to put on my turtleneck. But COVID has been pushing up park attendance in Maryland, but hurting park upkeep. We'll fill you in next.
And we'll take you out of this world with a Baltimore woman. Don't go away.
Jordan knows he shouldn't eat this entire bowl of nachos, but tonight he's earned that right. Because a few hours ago, in the middle of happy hour, he recognized a sign. Not from the gods or a bolt of lightning, but from a double heart, a kissy face, and a fourth ha in ha ha ha. That's when Jordan knew he was buzzed. So when it was time to go, he got a ride home instead of driving. Be a legend like Jordan. Recognize your buzzed warning signs and get a ride home. Buzz driving is drunk driving.
More people have been going to state parks during the pandemic, according to Maryland State Park Service. But the parks are finding it hard to get funding to hire more permanent staff and upkeep. CNS's Julia Rozier went to Greenbelt Park to see how park leaders are trying to solve the problem.
State parks have grown in popularity since March 2020 when the pandemic forced businesses to close. Not only did they become popular, but the numbers of people going to parks shattered records. Media relations manager of the Maryland Department of Natural Resources, Greg Bortz, says the pandemic saw a large increase in attendance, which had already been trending upward for several years. Records were broken despite pandemic-related temporary closures of campgrounds, cabins, and popular beaches at state parks.
As the pandemic continues, park attendance is still growing. According to the Maryland Department of Natural Resources, there was a 45% increase in park attendance in 2020. The website says that in 2020, the park had over 21.5 million visitors, up 6.6 million from 2019. Reporting from Greenbelt, Julia Rozier, CNS TV News.
Now from Earth to space and back tonight. The Blue Origin crew is safely back on land. Most of you know that Captain Kirk or actor William Shatner made history as the oldest astronaut at 90, but Another crew member made her mark as Baltimore's first space visitor. Audrey Kristen Powers grew up in Charm City and went to Mount DeSales High School. She now works as Blue Boss at Blue Origin. Oh, and claims the title of part-time astronaut. Now that is seriously cool stuff, man. It's so weird. How can you go into space and be like above the age of 90?
Such a great accomplishment.
Yeah.
It looked like it didn't even phase him either. Yeah. He was just rolling with the punches.
For sure. But make sure you check us out online at cnsmaryland.org and follow us on Twitter at cnsmd.
You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/marylandcns and on YouTube at cnsmaryland.
Thank you for joining us. Have a good evening.